Today we are very happy to have Yuya Tanizaki again. And his topic speaking today will be modifying instanton sum in young meals in QCD. So Yokoso, Yuya.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction. Yeah, today, yeah, I'm talking about my recent work with Mikhat Onza based on this work. So topic is about instanton sums, so summation over all topological sector in the young meals theory. So in usually when we do partial integral methods, then we define partition function of the young meals theory by doing summing up all possible gauge field with this kind of action. So first term is kinetic term, and the second one is a topological term. But then, what does this summation really mean? So usually, so this question arises when the space of gate, so configuration space is disconnected in some kind of quantum number. And in the case of SUN gate field, we have a good topological number called instanton number. Given by really this term, so 1 over h pi square over integration of your coordination state time of this topological charge. And this is quantized to integer. And what is known for this kind of instanton number is, so if we have gauge connection A and A prime with the same instanton number, then what is known is, so this one is locally look like SUN one form field, but because of the non-trivial topology, so there is could be some non-trivial transition function should be introduced when going from one coordinate to the another coordinate. But if we have two different such gauge field with the same instanton number, then if you take the difference, then this is globally well-defined SUN valued one form. So once you take a difference, then there is no need for difficulty of transition function. So using this fact, what we really mean by this path integral is summing up all over topological number given by integer and multiply this U1 phase depending on your topological number.
One question. So which manifold is M?
So here I'm considering some so closed four-dimensional, let's see, I think I consider spin manifold.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, because you said that if A minus A prime have zero instanton number, that's globally well-defined?
Yeah.
Could I have for instance, if I have a U1 bundle and the manifold is S2 times S2, I have...
So in the case of U1 bundle, there's another monopole charge, and that gives a distinction of the topological sector, and that kind of distinction also happens if you consider SUN mod GN, but what is known by old work, for example, Pambao in 80, says that basically, in the case of SUN gauge connection, if you take a difference with the same topological number, then it's only given by instanton charge. So it really, so that subtlety really depends on your global choice of SUN. And yeah, so what we really mean by this is, so this delta A is a SUN valued, so globally well-defined one-form field, and you integrate over this. And here, theta A nu is the sum reference gauge field, SUN gauge field. So this part is affected by non-trivial transition function with instanton number is equal to nu. And because of this fact, so choice of the specific reference gauge field does not affect the value of this integration, and I call it this as g of nu for your manifold n. So this is what we really mean by when we define Yamil's theory, and summing up all possible instanton with given this U1 phase, you define a theta vacuum of the Yamil's theory.
Sorry, where is the theta dependence?
Theta dependence appears.
Oh, that's theta. That's theta.
Yeah,
oh, sorry. Yeah.
So this is
good.
Yeah. So one question that arises is, so why do we have to sum up, take all summation over nu? So this could be one question, and so this question arises when BPSD instanton was found, and this interpret so answer to this question in so standard answer to this question is it is necessary for locality, I think, to found out in the context of high energy given by Karan, Dashen, Gross in some mid 70 and also by Jack Cube Freddy. Yeah. And some other people, yeah, those people. So idea is, so locality or cluster decomposition property of so some quantum field theory requirement of locality for quantum general quantum field theory is if you have some pick up some manifold, closed manifold, and take this joint union of it, then requirement of locality basically says that partition function should be given by just multiple of two independent path integrals.
Excuse me. And can we think of shifting the instanton of a gauge field as a symmetry of the theory?
Could you repeat the question?
Can you think of shifting the instanton mu by mu to mu by one as a symmetry of the theory?
Let's see. I do not know.
But the partition function is invariant on the
partition function is invariant.
Because it's sum of all the mu's.
But doesn't it give extra phase of e to the I theta?
It should be a minus one form symmetry.
So somehow, is it correct to think that on this SUN gauge theory, your F is the curvature 2-form induced by a connection 1-form on the SUN gauge bundle?
Yes, right.
Okay. Now this curvature 2-form has a cohomology class.
Mm-hmm.
And normally the partition functions I have seen actually are adding stuff with respect to the cohomology class of the curvature 2-form. But here you're in evaluating inner product of curvature 2-form with itself over the manifolds. You just get the number z.
Yes.
Shouldn't your partition function have two variables? Yeah, like your instanton moduli space has somehow needs to be connected components which are parameterized by some kind of D2 brain charge on this four manifold together with D0 brain charge. Now you're just adding over D0 brain charge, which are these numbers which are integers.
So, but I think for PSUN, those co-dimension to D2 effect plays an important role, but for SUN, I do not know, I do not aware of such kind of thing. So it's really, I think, subtle dependence of SUN versus SUN mod GN, I think. And what I know is, I think for SUN, basically, only topological distinction is given by instanton number, but for SUN mod GN, for example, if manifold is S2 cross S2, then what kind of GN monopole charge can be inside? But that subtlety appeared only for non-simply connected group, I think.
So I'm curious, why are you restricting to the spin case? Why are you restricting to spin case?
Because in later I will consider QCD and anyway I will introduce fermion, but maybe I do not need to assume spin structure.
Do you know the statement that you explained there, that if you assume two UN bundles have the same instanton number, they are, in their topology the same? Is it also true if you have non-orientable many?
Also for non-orientable, maybe.
I don't know how to define.
I'm assuming orientable too because I call it spin. Yeah.
Here you're assuming the tender bundle is trivializable.
Can I ask for an elaboration? So I thought that I would have guessed that with the theta term, you might even need a spin structure already here. Because the spin structure, in some sense, causes the Witten effect. I mean, the theta term causes the Witten effect, so you kind of get some, non-trivial lines that you need to specify out there.
But you said that the lines are going to have spin?
Yeah.
But is it C2 well-defined or not? Non-orientable, but in any case, in my talk, basically, I'm assuming orientability.
I'm asking about the spin structure. I'm not asking about orientability. Not C1, but C2. I'm asking about C2.
Such kind of generalization may get consideration more deeper and may find some new thing. But for this talk, let's assume very simple cases.
Sure.
Okay, so. Refinement of locality basically requires this property. And another fact is, so instanton, so basically any instanton number can exist on any manifold, at least I assume those kind of structure. So because of this property, if I consider so fixed topological sector in disjoint union, then basically this just give sum of two independent partition function with arbitrary instanton sector with constraining nu1 plus nu2 equal to nu. So because of this property, if we, for example, pick up only one of the instanton sectors, that locality requirement cannot be obeyed. So to solve that locality constraint, what we do is define your partition function as some weight times g of nu to the n, and substitute this expression into here. Then what you will get is f nu plus nu prime should be given by f. So basically just substituting this into here and requiring that property should obey for any m and m prime, then basically you get necessary and sufficient condition for this f nu obeys this requirement. And so basically you can solve this equation by saying that f of nu is just given by f of 1 times nu, and calling f of 1 is given by this e of minus I theta, then you get a nu theta. So in this way, so to satisfy this locality requirement, you have to sum up all possible instanton, and this weight should obey this kind of multiplicative property under the instanton number. So this is why in usual Yamil theory we, or in usual SUNK theory we are summing up all possible instantons. So taking into this fact, let's consider two questions. So can we modify or instanton sum without violating this kind of locality axiom? And if possible, then so what happens for, so what the physical consequence? So I want to answer these two questions.
Maybe a naive question. For a fixed choice of degree V, fixed choice of degree, you call it V or nu or something.
Nu, yes.
How do you know that your locality implies that the right-hand side of that equality is finite?
Nice.
So on the left, z nu of m disjoint union m prime, pick one number.
I see.
How do you know the right-hand side is a finite sum? I just want to see how do you guys in physics see it.
So at least within the physical regular, so you can show that so this kind of
Yeah,
the action
sure.
can be bounded by h pi square over g square times nu for instanton sector. So this does not automatically mean that this should be convergent, but basically this seems to.
You mean absolute value? Absolute value.
Oh, sorry, it's absolute value. Yeah.
Is that the direction? It's greater than mu.
Yeah, right. No. So here I take it positive. So this is a lower bound. So basically, this seems to say that it is given by. So yeah, so this seems to suggest that as nu goes to larger and larger, so partition function becomes
so
exponentially small,
okay.
And this sum seems to converge.
So
yeah. At
least
this
is the idea. Excuse me. So all the question about the whether instanton is sum all over, is there some discussion already in the past on the PSU and gauge theory?
I do not know the explicit reference, but basically it is an application of this same argument. So I think people implicitly or explicitly know about the fact that we should sum up all possible topological sector to satisfy this kind of decomposition property.
So am I correct that you just mentioned how separate or their paper already have
right,
PSU
so what they did is
well, they're talking about something over the discrete two-form class.
Yeah.
It's a bit different.
Right, and they uncover the relation between those factors with a set of line operator or extended operator as an observable. Yeah, I think that's my understanding of the Ahronisai touch bus paper.
They treat the sum over instanton as established.
Yeah. Okay, so this first question, so can we modify that instanton sum without violating locality? So this one is answered by Seibert in 2010, saying that so by adding some topological degree of freedom, so you can establish that you can restrict so possible summation of instanton number to
to mount integer multiple of some another integer p. So this is some integer. And to do it, so to do it explicitly, so let's add some so U1 three form gauge field. This is dynamical. Let me pause. Small c and require equation of motion satisfying 1 over 8 pi square trace f square is equal to p times 1 over 2 pi dc. So basically adding some extra three-form gauge field and require this constraint. And the important thing is this equation, so you just require local equation motion, so this is just a local constraint. And because of this fact, so locality is not violated. And so requiring this equation motion, then let's compute your topological charge. Then, so just this is an instanton number, and using that equation of motion, you get dc over 2 pi, and by canonical quantization of U1 charge, this is quantized to integer, so the result is topological charge should be a multiple of integer p. So first question is, so in just Yamil theory, to satisfy locality, you have to sum up all possible instanton. But adding some extra topological degree of freedom explicitly given by U1 three-form gauge field, then requiring local equation of motion, you can satisfy or you can modify the possible instanton sum. So first answer is yes, by adding extra topological degree of freedom.
Can you say what is the term you add to the Lagrangian?
Right, so in terms of Lagrangian, so full Lagrangian is given by usual Yamil's term and Yamil's theta term. And so as a Lagrange multiplier field, you add 2 pi periodic scalar field. And and you just put this equation of motion here. Then as an equation of motion of chi, this local constraint is established.
Oh, let me just ask a very dumb notational question. So when you write absolute phi, absolute f squared, you mean the Yagmil's term, and just f squared, you mean the topological, the statement,
yeah.
Right?
So,
I mean,
right,
as long as it's consistent, as long as that's,
yeah,
as long as I can.
Yeah, so sorry.
I actually had the same question. Is this like f wedge f? And F wedge star,
yeah,
half star,
yeah, yeah,
all over,
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
yes,
so
yes,
sorry,
yes, yes,
I was not clear. Yeah. Star.
Cool.
F,
okay.
Okay.
That's very helpful.
So,
yeah.
So one question. From the point of view of the argument you gave there, what is happening here for the instanton sum is effectively as if you were multiplying the theta angle by phi. Because, I mean,
mm-hmm,
on the left,
yes,
the sum goes over the integers.
Right.
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 Those are multiples of phi. So this is. How is this different from just multiplying the angles by p?
So what happens is, so because of this equation of motion, so this of g of nu, so by doing that restriction, this g of nu becomes zero unless nu is a multiple of p. So because of that, so if f of nu is not inside, then you can say f of nu can be zero. So because of that, so right, if you call f of 1 as e of minus I theta, then it becomes basically. So yeah, so you effectively you have to multiply p
I understand. So so in the for the partition function, it seems that it's just you could compute it by just multiplying theta by p.
Right, effectively, right, exactly. So, usually theta periodicity was 2 pi, but because of this restriction, what happens is, so theta periodicity is now become 2 pi over p periodic instead of usual 2 pi periodicity.
The function is still different, right? I mean, you don't, when you change theta, you do not project out sectors with the new one, new is not multiple p.
Yeah, yeah.
For the sector that
I understand that right.
Right. Yeah, so it's indeed related to this second question. So locally, it really looks like just we multiply p in front of theta, and but do we really get the sum? Some new physics by modification. So this is a question I want to answer from now.
This term also shows up on the world volume of the V3 frame, right?
Yes, exactly. Right. And in order to understand the vacuum structure, that observation is very important. So let's now talk about vacuum structure. of this modified Yamil's theory. So to understand the theory, so first we want to understand what the symmetry of this theory or what the possible observable of this theory is. So by modifying instanton sum, theory has, so as in the usual Yamil theory, it has GN one form symmetry, but in addition to it, you get G of three form GP symmetry also exists. And content is so this GN one form symmetry is a center symmetry as in the case of Yamil's theory. So if you consider the Wilson loop given by this first order product, and taking fundamental trace, and basically this symmetry operation acts on this line operator and changes the GN phase given by, yeah, which is the center of the SUN gauge group. So this is the one symmetry, and so generator of it is called, what is called, codimension to topological defect given by what is called of written surface operator. So basically, it can be regarded as a world seed of the Dirac string emitted from Tokhoff monopole. Yeah. And its closed version of it is the surface operator.
Really a modified theory? Is it really a modified Lagrangian, or is
it
just a dual description of the same theory?
It's a different theory. So it's a really modified different theory. Not the same.
Because every time we use this, I don't know, like Giovanni did this for QCD years ago, and we use it also in another way, where we say that it's just a dual description. But we can't think of having the theory in terms of a three-fold gauge field, or
so
let's
see.
This is dynamical.
Yeah, so this C is really dynamical, so it's really a different theory compared with Yamil. So basically adding extra degree extra but heavy degree of freedom, we are,
but
does it
have propagating degrees of freedom, right?
So it doesn't affect the propagating degree of freedom, but topologically they can be different. And I will talk about how they are different. So right. So especially one big difference is the existence of this three-form symmetry. So let me first talk about it. And so
can I make sure? So in that Lagrangian action, you have a gauge connector A and C.
Yes.
Dynamical. How about chi so that?
Chi, this is also a dynamical scalar. And basically, for example, solving the equation of motion of C, so D of C is completely given by A. So up to gauge equivalence, equation of motion of C can be completely solved by or fixed by dynamical SU and gauge field. So C itself does not add propagating degree of freedom. And on the other hand, if you solve the equation of motion of C, then basically it's the decay is zero, so locally chi should be constant. So again, chi is not propagating degree of freedom. So locally, so this is the same with Yamil's theory, but globally it could be different, and I will want to uncover how they are different.
So
just a comment for mathematicians like us. So when we say dynamical, we mean that the summing over all the gauge equivalent configurations.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's not, then
I'm actually wondering, because you're looking at your curvature form,
mm-hmm.
and you're adding this two form to it, which is D of C. So
it's a four form.
It's a
two form on the complex surface. The way we work over complex.
It's
so,
okay, sure.
It's a four form on the four manifold.
Yes,
so
yeah.
Can you? So this term that you're adding already is written in terms of four forms. But is it like you're trying to take your curvature two forms, and you add cohomology classes to them, or what is it you're trying to do? Because
so,
I still don't see how your theory is different from the previous one.
So,
which she asked.
Yeah, so at least, I'm trying to answer those questions by looking at the operators and.
Essentially,
yeah.
I'm asking, can you write this term that you added as a trace of F prime square, where F prime is related to a combination of F and C.
But he's also doing something else, right? He's also integrating over chi, which is the important
so
bit.
Yeah, so
yeah.
The chi, I completely don't understand what
it's like a Lagrange multiplier, so it's like, right? So it's like just
it's
imposing a constraint
scalar.
On the
yeah.
sum.
Imposing, okay.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
So yeah, I don't
okay.
think you can describe in that way. Yeah.
Uh-huh. So.
Yeah.
I mean, when we introduce the Lagrange multiplier, we can also think that depending on what equation of motion now we apply, we get to a dual description, two different dual descriptions of the same thing. And one will get us to the previous Lagrange, and the other one will get us just to the free form with chi.
But the thing that he is like composing there is not a constant in the original theory. It's not a fixed. Like it takes different values.
Yeah.
Like normally, when you do the duality using a Lagrange multiplier, you take some trivial thing like the Bjarke identity. And then pretend you've imposed it by a Lagrange multiplier.
Yeah,
it's
right.
Not this,
yeah.
Trace
in this case, I'm not doing some kind of abelian duality game. So
it's
really adding the extra degree of freedom and
so
okay, making theory a different theory.
Why can't
they take different
things? I mean, you can always write the trace of F square as some four.
If you want, you can figure out.
Yeah, but
he's essentially just making theta that had particular quantization.
With the
so the integral
of
EC
over
the
right,
that's
right.
That's
okay,
right.
Okay,
that's
okay.
Right.
But now I get it.
It's just like Lexia with the ZP gauge.
Right, yeah, in phenomenological language, this chi is now dynamical axiom,
yeah.
But it is now restricted to discrete value, that is another interpretation.
So have you thought a little bit also about the case where chi becomes dynamical? Where
mm-hmm.
you have, where, can you say something? Well, when you put a kinetic term for it, so it has to be really.
So I can add some kinetic term for chi and chi, then theory becomes slightly locally different, and some consequence that I will talk about should be modified. But basically, after doing some computation, I will reinterpret those things from the viewpoint of symmetry, and that symmetry protected statement becomes robust under those deformations.
I think it's what he said, not that P is different from 1. Like, if P is
right,
one,
so,
both things are the same.
Right, when P is 1, this is go back to usual Yamil's theory, but when P is larger than 1, you really modify the theory.
Right.
Excuse
me, but for the gauge transformation for the sphere, they say. It looks like you just add maybe ZP, three-phone gauge theory, D
do you modify a transformation for the A? So let's say A chi C has K transformation. Do you modify the transformation?
No, yeah. SUM gauge transformation is kept intact,
yeah.
But yeah. So basically, we are just adding GP topological BF theory,
yeah.
And couple it in a relatively trivial way. Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
So the gauge formation of the KC does not involve any gauge parameter on the F.
Right. Yeah, at least before introducing background gauge field for this higher form symmetry, it is not affected at all. Yeah, and so, right, so we have one form symmetry, and in addition to it, because of the existence of those three form gauge fields, so I can add
sorry, can I just ask one more question there? So if we set t equals to 1, and we impose the constraint,
mm-hmm.
Are we not saying, we are saying the trace of f squared is exact, right?
C is a three-form gauge field, so this can be non-trivial gauge transformation. So basically, its equation of motion just say that C becomes, when this one, C is just Chan-Simons action with SUM gauge connection. Yeah, so still non-trivial. And you can consider this kind of a closed volume operator when M3 is a closed manifold of your four-dimensional space-time, and you can basically do GP transformation to it. So it's really like a volume version of the Wilson line operator, and you can consider this operation. And in this case, this is three-form symmetry, so generator is given by four-dimension four topological defect, and you see, as I said, if you solve equation of motion in terms of C, chi becomes constant, so that topological defect is really given by U of chi of some point. So this is a generator of this GP3 form symmetry. So when P is 1, again, this symmetry operation becomes trivial, and it is not really a symmetry. So P is 1, it's consistent with the fact that it goes back to the Yang-Mills theory. But when P is larger than 1, then this operation is really a physical distinct operation. So this is one of the good signatures that we are doing something different from the usual Yang-Mills theory. And let's see. So now, since we identify symmetry, so we want to look at the vacuum structure using the help by symmetry. So especially to understand the vacuum structure, it is useful to know about what kind of toothed anomaly exists in this theory. And in this theory, So there is GNP order topological anomaly. Between so theta angle periodicity theta 2 pi over NP. So in a recent language it is called generalized anomaly with minus power of symmetry, or it's related to the time reversal symmetry, time reversal anomaly of Yang-Mills or global inconsistency of Yang-Mills, and that higher form symmetry GN1 cross GP3. And so let me first, before giving a derivation, let me first give a physical consequence. So first thing is, So vacuum has NP branch structure as a function of theta angle. So what really happens is, so if I plot ground state energy density as a function of theta. And for simplicity, let me plot n equal p, n equal 2, p equal 2k's. And so there are, in total, there are four branches. And energy behaves like this. So each of them has four pi periodicity. And something like this. And
are the four branches exactly the same by shifting? Like if I move one to the left or the right, I make two of them coincide.
Right. Yeah.
Exactly
basically, by shifting the set angles, they are, all of them are related. And vacuum periodicity was now 2 pi over p. And in this case, p equals 2. So vacuum periodicity is pi. And you really find that having four branches, this kind of pi periodicity is realized. And difference between yellow and red or orange curve is, so in yellow one, if you solve the equation of motion, chi has a two possibility, modulo 2 pi, and for yellow one, chi is zero. And for orange one, so pi is equal to pi, mod 2 pi. And interesting thing is, for example, let's consider, you consider one special direction, and for example, and let's assume that you are now theta equal zero space. So basically, you have a possibility of your vacuum over your space-time. And so if your universe is living here, then your state is minimal energy. So basically, nothing interesting could happen. But it could be interesting to ask, what happens if our universe or our vacuum is trapped in this orange region? So our space-time, so our vacuum is now in this orange branch. Then, so usually in the context of usual discrete symmetry breaking or some false vacuum, so from the viewpoint of energy density, ground state energy density, you are inside a false vacuum. So physically, so what could happen is, so inside your space-time, there could be a formation of some bubble of true vacuum. And for example, if you lived here, then if vacuum bubble is created, then because this one has lower energy, so this vacuum won't expand. And when this domain wall of the true vacuum hits, for example, us, then our universe really dies. And yeah, all living creatures should die at all. So this is a usual case. In the case of usual false vacuum, if our cosmos or universe is trapped inside a false vacuum, and if really vacuum transition happens, then this is a usual field, what would happen?
Sorry, one question. For this transition to happen, you must have data being dynamical, right?
Right, but so in this case, chi is possibly dynamical, so possibly this process could happen in principle. But interesting thing is, in our case, so this is prohibited. So this is something a little bit interesting here. So in our case,
you're saying that the process that is actually prohibited.
So in our specific modification of the Yamil theory, this process is prohibited. And the reason why is here, so basically you have a domain wall, so and this domain wall is some three volume created by three volume operator. And so as a, so I have to show the anomaly computation, and I will do after this, but the explanation is, so this so three volume domain wall is charged under GP3 form symmetry because of the mixed anomaly between theta angle periodicity and this three form symmetry. So basically, in order to create this vacuum bubble, so you have to really insert this three volume operator as a domain wall here by hand, and there's no possible dynamical process creating this kind of domain wall. So the fact that you have this three form symmetry prohibits the dynamical creation of a real bubble. So
why can't you create a pair?
Hmm?
Why can't you create a pair?
But if you are so
like two shells.
But so this one and yeah, so maybe so creating very on top of it, and if inside is again red,
yes,
then it is possible.
Then
but in that case, so energy density from inside and outside are the same, then basically domain wall tension should mean, and it should not expand, I think.
But even that is, I mean, you can probably argue that, you know, if this generator e to the I chi is topological, you can probably, you should be able to move it in between the domain walls, and then, like, that also, you know, that's prohibited. I think there's probably a contradiction there. I think you can probably use that argument to say that it's...
Mm.
So do you think the domain wall would have finite tension if chi had a kinetic term?
If chi had a kinetic term, So naively, so that's so domain wall tension itself is become finite. But point is, because of the mixed anomaly or explicitly in our case, we have this topological coupling, and the existence of this topological coupling prohibits the creation of this kind of wall configuration, even if you modify the chi squared term. So even if you modify your theory, so long as this uniform symmetry is kept intact, this process is prohibited.
If P is equals 1, is like having only the yellow.
Could you repeat the question?
If P is equals 1, is like having only the yellow.
Right, so if P is equal 1, so this symmetry doesn't exist, so, so there is no protection by uniform symmetry.
What happens at pi?
At pi?
In the locus square over pi. Yeah.
Here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Your theta is a pi, so basically, so role of yellow and orange flip, but yeah, so basically you can do the same argument. Yes.
Excuse me. When you say chi is zero, chi is pi, is that one of them is charged on the three volume symmetry, the other is not? When you say chi is zero, chi is pi. So chi.
So basically, so what I mean is, so by solving with, or by summing up all possible C3 three form gauge field contribution, chi is quantized to zero over pi. And transition from 0 to pi is charged under the domain wall. So that changing process is possible only after inserting volume operator here.
Earlier, you write a symmetry generator, which is a zero dimension object. You write EI chi of point. Is that chi related to this thing?
Yes, it's related to that chi. Yes. So basically, chi is so because chi is a generator of the symmetry, chi cannot change the value. And by when inserting the charged object, then at that point, when chi hits that point, then chi can jump by the discrete value. So basically, that is the physics because of this topological coupling.
Sorry to repeat, but you're saying that even if we have a kinetic term for chi, then this process, the bubble nucleation from the false vacuum to the true vacuum, would not happen dynamically.
Right. So in order to create this dynamical domain wall, you really have to break GP3 form symmetry explicitly. So, but the kinetic term of time itself.
The spherical domain wall is not charged with the CP.
You're looking for
a
kinetic term for
So neutral domain wall under the three form symmetry can be created. So for example, if you are trapped in this vacuum, then you have a lower energy vacuum. So this force vacuum decay is completely okay. And that process is neutral under this three form symmetry. So in that case it is completely fine. So what is prohibited is the vacuum decay for different colors. So now let's look at the anomaly. So derivation of anomaly is so idea is so we have GN1 plus GP3 form symmetry and introduce the background A field for them. And I report two background two form gate field and background four form gate field. And I will show that if I compute partition function under the existence of these background gate field and shift by original periodicity of the theta angle, then I will get some overall phase difference of the partition function. So originally partition function was 2 pi over p periodic, but under the existence of these background gate field, you get some extra phase.
So it's not a mixed anomaly, it's just an anomaly of the ZP symmetry?
So this is a interesting point. So usually, so naively, so I will explain, but this would be GP4 form gauge field, but so to make gauging correctly, this is a GMP4 form gauge field, and constraint is P times D is equal to N over 4 pi D with P plus D.
Oh, I see. So that's where the two group stuff comes in.
Yeah,
so
something
see.
Related to two group. Yeah, two group. Yeah, I'm not sure if this is for higher form, between higher forms, or I'm not sure whether four group or two group, but something related to two group. Yeah. So idea is, so if we have an intersection point of two conventional two defects, then that activates that three form symmetry in a fractional way. Yeah, that is what is real.
Excuse me, actually, I'm not sure what the point chi zero pi spatial, subspatial point on other. What you have a three form P. So, voice.
Yeah. So, what happened? So let's do a path integral for C because so it is linear in C and E over 2 pi BC. So doing this path integral and basically local equation of motion says chi is constant. So let's chi equal to chi 0 and constant. So you now get so and yeah. So now I'm doing the by doing the path integral over local fluctuation, I got this constraint. And now I'm doing the summation over doing the topological sector for this U1 three form gauge field. Then what I will get is chi 0. P and 1 over 2 pi times 2 pi. And so this is the topological number of C. And basically this is so in order for this to be non-zero, then you say chi zero have to quantize to pi over p times g. So in this case, you can pass integral explicitly, and you can show that so chi should be to pi over p quantized, and now p equal to.
Oh, sorry, sorry, you already said p equal to.
Yeah.
So generally it's 2 pi over p. There are
several. No, generally 2 pi over p and.
Yeah, many vectors are competing.
Right. And okay. So now let's try to introduce these background gauge field. And by introducing this background gauge field, so we have this kind of higher form gauge transformation. So this is one form gauge transformation. And under this one form gauge transformation, after getting this, the field strength of SUN gauge connection is also changes to the same way. And by introducing this four-form gauge field, then I also have to introduce a three-form gauge transformation. And since this should act on the shift of that three-form gauge field, then C is transformed in this way.
This is what I was asking.
Yeah, so after introducing, so for example, so instead of doing this as a background, but instead of summing up all possible B and D, then yeah, this thing really happens. And for example, in the case of B, that really means that you are treating SUN mod GN gauge theory instead of SUN. And in that case, this really affects new topological sector.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And so basically, so this means that so gauge invariant combination is given by, instead of F, it is given by F minus B. And similar thing is, it is given by, instead of this speed strength of C, it should be given by DC minus D. So basically doing this replacement in the Lagrangian, but so subtle point is this. So if you consider the Lagrange multiplier term for this process, what would you obtain is so this is what happens for the SUN instanton number, and you will get. And this is what happens for some topological number of three-form gauge field. And you get this. So you now get this constraint. But now I can explain this weird constraint. So now equation of motion of chi says that, so basically this is equal to zero. So you can say, find that, so this one is equal to E of minus 1 over 8 pi square x square. So now doing the integration over your spacetime, and you get this. The first term is 2 pi over p times integer quantized, and the second one is in this normalization, so this is pz quantized. And second term is integer quantized. So in total, anyway, this quantity is integer quantized. But now, what I wanted to introduce is other B field. I wanted to introduce GN2 from gate field and other GD field. Naively, I wanted to introduce GP4 form gate field. And this means that this wants to be integer quantized because of the multiplication of PD. But here, I only have N as a collection, so this wants to be 1 over NG quantized if I wanted to introduce top left flux in order to gauge GN one form symmetry. So,
question. So the wedge multiplier term is not inherent under the one form gauge symmetry?
Which one?
So the wedge multiplier term is not a gauge invariant under the one form symmetry that introduced.
So chi is just a scalar, so it is
yeah,
neutral.
But the rest of the terms.
Rest of the term. This one?
Yes.
So this part is invariant under one form gauge transformation.
Under one form symmetry, the F and B transform separately. That term is not cannot be written as just independent F minus B.
Let's see. So constraint is so what I really do is so here instead of SUN gauge connection, I treat it as a UN gauge connection, gauge field strength.
Okay.
And I'm putting constraint is trace of F tilde is N times P. Yeah.
So
that is the original S. Yeah, so this is F2, sorry. Yeah, I was not. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm here following the notation by Kapustin and Cyborg's 2014 paper. Yes. And yeah, I'm following that convention here. And so everything except for this one has to be integer quantized. If I naively think this deep field as a GP4 form gate field, so that means that I cannot introduce top left flux in a consistent manner. That means that I could not have gauged the one form symmetry in this process. So if B were GP four form gauge field, so GN1 was not gauged. So to evade this problem, instead of P times D, I do not require that P times D is not 2 pi quantized, but it can be fractionalized by or this fractionalization could be activated by having codimension 2 defects for the one form gate field by this amount. And this is some originary so 3 form background. So this is a relation that I have required as a background gauge field for P and D. And now, so under this constraint, then fractionalization of 1 over N coming out of this term and this term cancels out, and remnant is completely integer quantized. So now, by requiring this one, so I could have, so GN1 times GP3 is now successfully quantized. Successfully gauged. And now under these constraints, I just have to shift Yamil's sheet action by sheta plus 2 pi over p in the existence of d. And yeah, it's almost over time, so it gives this one. So basically, it says that so if I shift theta by 2 pi over p, so background gauge field for 3-form gauge field appears as an overall phase of the partition function. And so that means that so shift of theta, and theta is basically equal to chi, so change of the Lagrange multiplier field by fractional number of 2 pi basically means that that process requires some, or that process is charged under the three-form symmetry. And if you repeat this process p times, then you get theta over pi b and b. Then you get, so basically you are doing this process p times, you get p of d of gc dd. But noticing that you have this equation, then so effect of B as an overall phase can be eliminated by this constraint. So this is now GP3 neutral. And I have erased that branch structure, but if I again draw this kind of thing. So now I can interpret this energy dependence of the theta angle from the viewpoint of this anomaly. So n equal p equal to n 0 pi 2 pi 3 pi 4 pi. And that means that so if I change theta from 0 to pi, this is related to this process, then as a phase of the partition function or SPD phase of the background gate field, then you, so some phase depending on this three-form gate field is activated. So this means that this difference is charged under three-form, so GP three-form symmetry, in this case, phase two. But if you do it twice, and if you compare this point and this point, then so overall phase is just given by this background gauge field for GN one form symmetry. So this difference is now GP3 neutral. And physical consequence is so basically. So SPD nature is continuous under this deformation. So basically what it's saying that so if you consider vacuum decay from this red branch to yellow branch, then that process is charged under three-form symmetry. So domain wall excitation is now charged under three-form, but the existence of this three-form symmetry prohibits such process, so this is prohibited. But decay from here to here is now neutral under those three-form symmetry, only charged under one-form symmetry. So by exciting Chan-Simon excitation on the wall, everything is consistent. So So it has some interesting consequence for the vacuum decay. So now let me summarize. So yeah, usually in Young-Mills theory, you have to sum up all possible instantons because of the requirement of locality. But that requirement is true for usually SUM gauge theory, but by adding some topological degree of freedom, you can modify a little bit. And as a consequence, if you modify in, for example, I pick up some specific example, and I only sum up p times the integer instanton, then there is an extra three-form symmetry related to the volume operator. And this three-form symmetry and one-form symmetry and theta angle periodicity has an interesting mixed anomaly, and it has some interesting consequence on the vacuum decay process. So that's all. Thanks very much for your attention.
Any questions?
So for adding this extra symmetry, in the level of your partition function, can you expect to see some kind of modularity similar to U1 gauge theory of vacua and vacua?
I'm not familiar, so
there's no marginal gauge coupling. But you probably wonder which first metric is
edge-wide marginal, but that's a different story. I see. Can you reduce the symmetry of this thing somehow to the U1 to the end?
U1 to the end?
Yep. You modify your two forms to a point that gauge symmetry induced gauge symmetry. We just pick up diagonal space.
Over SUN gauge. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think some adjoint Higgs field may be possible. And but it's quite open what would happen for that modification with combined with this modified instant or something. It's quite open. Something.
What happens if you have a
fermions? Right. Yeah, I to include the QCD, but I don't know. So, interesting thing is, for example, in QCD with one flavor, in the case of usual instanton sum, you are summing up all instanton, and as a consequence of ABG anomaly, there is no chiral symmetry, even if you tune your mass of fermion to the massless point.
So, this is still discrete.
No, in the case of one flavor, even this green symmetry does not exist. Yeah, or just it's just a fermion parity. But if you restrict this instanton sum related to the fact that this fractional C down periodicity, there is a GP chiral symmetry. And as a consequence, all these different vacuum has the same energy. So now we are discussing the porous vacuum. So we were discussing whether this porous vacuum decay is possible or not. But related question is whether you have this spontaneous chiral symmetry breaking for that enhanced discrete symmetry due to instanton sum, whether you can consider whether domain wall connecting between them is possible or not. And the answer is because of the charged and the three-form symmetry, the domain wall excitation is prohibited. Yeah. So if you have a fermion with the massless points, then you have an enhanced chiral symmetry, and because of the anomaly with three-form symmetry, it is spontaneously broken.
So this theory, if we don't introduce chi, but we do introduce the three form, the theory has two minus one form symmetries, right? Like the trace of F squared and the integral of the periods of the fifth rank of the.
Oh, over C, you mean?
Integral of DC over F. So what I'm asking is, we have in this theory we have two U1 minus one form symmetry, so to say, and then you've gauged one of them by coupling to chi, but the orthogonal combination is still there.
In this special case, because of some speciality of chi is now this kind of thing, P3, and possible theta term is theta f squared and maybe for theta hat PC3. And because of the existence of theta and theta hat, basically. Yeah, you seem to have two independent two minus one form symmetry or two by periodicity. But in this case, equation motion relate F squared and PDC, so basically you can combine this into theta plus theta half over F squared. So in this case, you do not have an orthogonal direction. But the interesting thing that could be explored is, so you can multiply another integer here. Then in that case, you cannot completely solve the equation of motion for theta and theta hat. So in that case, you have two different directions. And that question becomes very interesting if you consider non-trivial MM.
I was just trying to understand why is the why is the vacuum stable, right? Like the, so you have, when you're drawing the picture with the branches, there's several vacua, and you just argue that there's the one in the middle cannot decay to the other one.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, so in this case.
So I thought that maybe the charge index is the minus one from charge, which is left. Is that correct?
So index for prohibiting the vacuum decay is basically charge under three-form symmetry instead of minus one-form symmetry. But having two orthogonal directions could give a more complicated structure, so that direction is not yet explored, but that is an interesting direction.
Any more questions?
Can you relate the three-form global symmetry with the original one-form electric and magnetic?
So, one is broken, the other one's are broken, one is gauge, the other one's are gauge, or is not?
At least in this model, they are independent symmetry. Yeah, at least in this model, they are independent. Yeah.
So, at some point, you were saying there are some two-like structure?
Right.
One-form and
three-form? I see.
Can you be more precise what you mean? From gauge transformation, you don't see any two group structure, right?
So
you have higher group structures, the gauge transformation will mix, but it's not the case here.
So, okay, yeah, but
you have this funny constraint, which ties together the one form and three form gauge fields.
Okay, but in order for this, so strictly speaking, I have to add some ordinary three form gauge field to make it well defined as a discrete symmetry. And in this case, this C, so in order for this constraint to be invariant under one form gauge transformation, then P times lambda 3 minus N over 2 pi. So here, extra term appears inside this auxiliary field.
That's right.
Yeah.
But it's a three-form. It's another three-form.
It appears in the auxiliary field to define this D as a discrete gauge field. Yeah. And I do not know how I should call it as this kind of structure, but
this higher group structure, this higher group symmetry is not anomalous here, or is it?
Not anomalous. So only has mixed anomaly with sheet angle periodicity. So this higher group structure itself doesn't have anomaly.
More comments, question?
I'm not even
coupling method.
Sure.